Thankful that you came on a night, Lord, that you chose to come to this earth, Lord, as a humble baby. And Lord, what a miracle that alone was. But Lord, the story doesn't end there. And Lord, we know the rest of the story. We thank you, Father. Amen.
Thank you, Simon and team. Good morning, everybody. Yesterday was a pretty exciting day in the church. Hottest food I think this church has ever served. It was Joseph and Eva's wedding. Let's congratulate them this morning. They're here this morning. I'm actually going to invite Joseph and his father-in-law to come up. I think they have something to share. So they can do that now. And for all who attended and all who maybe didn't attend, there's leftover food. And so today, Everyone is invited for lunch. So if you want some African food or Subway, then you're welcome to stay for lunch today. And welcome Joseph's new father-in-law this morning.
Once again, good morning to everybody. I just want to say a big thank you to Pastor Jeff and all the members of this congregation. I mean, whatever I saw yesterday was beyond my comprehension. I never thought my daughter and my son-in-law were going to have such a beautiful wedding. And the ladies who were working at the serving room, I'm so grateful to you. You did do everything humanly possible for this beautiful couple. So what we say in Africa is that when a cock crows in the morning, the only thing we say is, thank you very, very much. Yeda mwase.
I would say a very big thank you. And with a wedding we had yesterday, I learned two things from it. Like what you usually say in this room, that you should all move out of our comfort zone, it really worked yesterday. One, I moved the wedding from my comfort zone, which is from Toronto, where I have a lot of blacks, which I thought it could be more people to listen to, which I thought, or people might be thinking that people won't show up, but it also taught me a lesson that with the numbers I got here, it means that moving out of our comfort zone was the right thing, and it's something that you should all encourage ourselves to do all the time. Then another one, the lady who did the decoration, Andrea. The first time Pastor Jeff told her that you have to do the wedding decoration, she said, Joseph, I haven't done a wedding before, but I think I'll try this one. So she moved out of her comfort zone, and she tried the wedding. And everyone is proud of the colors. You must appreciate that. And then also, you also appreciate the members who came, and those of you who couldn't come, and you've had a lot of gifts. And you see, we all thank you for the numbers, and with the help, Pastor Jeff, and those who made the cake, everybody, Julia, and we are mostly grateful for whatever you've done. Thank you.
So if you haven't done so yet, personally congratulate them today. This morning I was privileged to be part of the musical practice. It's good times. And so I want to invite you all. I know you're already invited. This isn't like your first invitation. But this Friday, the musical is happening here at 1. And all are welcome to come. And there's actually invites in the the foyer, thank you. In the foyer that you can hand out to others as well. And the musical is also next Sunday during the service and next Sunday night at 7. Come out to that. It's really, really good. And the kids do a great job in that. Thirdly, in your bulletin, there's a changed high voltage schedule. And I want, if you have kids in high voltage, give that your attention, because there isn't high voltage during a few Sundays over the Christmas holidays. And finally, be careful out in the parking lot with ice. This is just a reminder of that. Rosemary fell yesterday, and she's fine. We'll pray for her. But but just be careful, because it's icy and snowy, and we want to all be safe. And for those who are not seniors or are physically chipper on their feet, try to save the paved parking lot right out front for seniors, so it's closer for them. And those of you who are seniors, feel free to park there. Join me in prayer this morning as we just pray for our service and our congregation. God, thank you for this awesome day. Thank you for, God, even to be able to let be led into worship, Lord, of you and remembering your birth and your coming for us, Lord, and even knowing that you are coming again. God, that you will restore that hope, you will restore that joy to completion, Lord, that you came to bring. God, we thank you so much for you and for your promises and for coming, God, to save us. And we thank you so much for this day, God, a new day to breathe, a new day to live, Lord, and give you thanks and to love and to enjoy. And God, I ask that you would be with those in our congregation who, God, are struggling with physical needs and hurt, Lord, and even for Rosemary, Lord, we ask that you'd bring healing and hope. God, that you would be just seen savior of all of our problems, all of our troubles, God, and that we would know you to be that, God, and we would be able to share that this season. Thank you for this wonderful time to gather, Lord, and to get to know each other, God, to praise you and to thank you. God, may you touch each one of our hearts this morning, God, with your spirit and with your love and with your joy. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'll invite Joyce or Cheryl, correct?
Our songs this morning. Why don't you stand with us? We're going to start off with Let Us Adore, which was a song that Trent led last Sunday. And it's a newer song. It is a Christmassy song. And the words just resonate with me, and I'll just read some of them to you. If you don't know the song, just listen to it, but it's simple, the chorus, to sing along. It says, "For the unclean and for the unholy, for the broken, the unworthy, the wounded, the hurting, the lost, and the lonely, you came, Jesus, you came." And it goes on to say, "Come, let us adore the one who came for us." And I was thinking this week about how Jesus came and he walked this earth and he experienced the emotions that we experience. And then he went on to heaven. And someday we're going to experience that as well because he came. Try and sing along with us. For the unclean, the unholy, for the broken, the unworthy, you came. Jesus, you came. For the wounded, for the hurting, for the lost, and for the lonely, you came. Jesus, you came.
Oh, come all ye faithful.
Savior,
faithful, bow before our Savior. Come, let us adore the one who came for us. Glory in the highest, praise the name of Jesus, our King has come. Oh, come, let us adore him, for he alone is worthy. Our King has come, our King.
So thankful, Lord, that the story doesn't end in the manger, but Lord, there's more miracles in the story, Lord, and Lord, we know how it ends, but we're thankful for where it starts. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Ages pre-K, 3 to grade 5. Okay, so this month we are celebrating Jesus' birth, and how much joy Jesus brings to us, right? So joy means we're smiling all the time. All the time. Inside we do, right? Because sometimes we are sad, and we're learning that we can still have joy because we belong to Jesus. Now this week at Jube Station, we had our Christmas party, and we had a lot of joy. And we actually also celebrated someone's birthday. And we thought it was pretty special because this lady has been helping us at Jube for, I don't know, forever. 17 years? You think 16 years she's been helping? Could be. Anyways, and we celebrated her birthday. And you know how old she is? 60. 60 years old. And she comes out and has fun with you guys every week at Jupe Station. And I think that is just amazing. And we also have a leader who's like 67 helping at Jupe Station. And we have some leader, you, me, no. No, not me. I try to cover the gray. I'm not there yet. And we have some leaders who are in their 50s, and I'm like, I am just amazed. And you know what? We had a father come and pick up his kids Wednesday, and he just said, you know what? I am so thankful my kids can come here to Jupe, and he's not from this church. And he looked in, and he saw all our leaders, and he's like, do you know how amazing it is that you have all these volunteers coming and helping you every week? And I said, yeah, I know how amazing it is. He goes, yeah, not many churches have that. And so he was really thankful, and I am too, that we have all these amazing leaders that help at Jupe and High Voltage and care for you guys. So they just are Jesus to you guys. So let's pray, and then we can go have some more joy, okay? Thank you, Lord, for this morning and for the boys and girls that are here today. Thank you that it's Christmas coming soon, and we can celebrate Jesus' birth together and anticipate, Lord, what is going to happen, and to know that nothing is impossible with you, Lord. That's so amazing. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
So much to be thankful for, and we are so blessed. And you see all of our children here. And we think, wow, this is an incredible blessing, an incredible gift, and all of the leaders. And we hear so much negativity about the millennials and the, you know, people falling away from the church and people leaving the church and all that kind of stuff. But I don't know if you get a chance to look around this congregation. We see young families with children. We see a ton of young people who love Jesus. We see young people who are serving. We got some that are going off in the missions field, starting some exciting journeys. We're going to hear some of that in the new year. And lots of good things that God is doing. And so that is partly because of you, because you love and you support your church. And we allow our young people and our children to express themselves and to do things a little out of the box. And I love our seniors, and we really appreciate our seniors, because sometimes they sit and they go, you know what, they don't sing the music that I really like. They don't. They're sometimes a little louder than I would like it to be, or they're a little crazy or a little wild. But you know what? It's all for the children. And if they're coming to church and they're learning to love Jesus, then we're willing to put up with a whole lot. And so I would like to give our seniors a big hand if we could do that this morning. And that is kudos to you, thumbs up, because you guys believe in our children and our young people. And we are a church that believes in empowering and letting our young people and our young adults go ahead and do what God has called them to do. And so every one of us has that passion. So, which leads to the next thing that I'm going to say before we have some wonderful interviews this morning. This is it was only a couple more Sundays before the year is over. And we would love it if you would help us as a church to meet our budget this year. And just, we have the offering slot there. And if you could pray, and maybe God is saying, you know what, I want you to give a little bit more this year to help LEMC meet their budget this year. And so we would encourage you to do that. Slip a little more into the offering envelope and stick it in there. And continue to support the ministries here at LEMC. We don't ask for money. We don't ever put pressure on you, but we do encourage you, if you believe in what is happening here and that the missionaries that we support and all the wonderful ministries, we want to encourage you to help us, partner with us in making these things even more of a reality in the new year. So thank you. So we've been hearing real stories from real people, and this morning we're going to invite Tim Ellis to come on up. Tim is He's been a part of LAMC for some time. I'm going to let him share a little bit about who he is, where he came from, a little bit about his family, and some of the neat things that God is doing in his life. Just grab one of those mics there, Tim, if you could. Thank you.
Nice stool.
Yeah, I know, it's very... This was a donation from the new hardware store in...
Bit of a plug there. 20 Main Street, Milverton.
So, Tim, maybe you can tell us a little bit about who you are, a little bit about your family, and how you ended up here at LAMC.
Well, my name is Tim. I'm married to Irene. We have three daughters, Quinlan, or no, I'll start at the top, Violet, Quinlan, and Isabella. And Violet's 16, Quinlan just turned 15, and Bella is 12. So it's pretty pretty busy, but they are a blessing, and honestly, they're pretty easy. Like they're no trouble yet. So
and they're girls, teenage girls.
Yeah, teenage girls. But no, they're wonderful. So yeah.
So you realize you're gonna have a whole list of people asking, "How did you do it with teenage girls? What are you doing?"
I think from the beginning we put them in God's hands and said, "You're gonna raise them and we'll help." And we both had really good upbringings with our families, and so it's been a blessing. We had a lot of people praying for us. I know both my grandmas, they told me many times that it's, you know, we pray for you guys every day and pray that you'll live for God. And I believe that when you live for God, he'll bless you. And so he has. So,
and I strongly believe in praying grandparents and extended family. I think it makes all the difference in the world. So you grandparents and aunts and uncles and spiritual grandparents, keep praying for our kids.
Yeah.
So how did you end up here at LAMC?
I'm not real sure. This was probably the last place. No, I'm just kidding. I guess we probably started coming here. Well, we explored coming here because of Simon and Laura, because we went to the Milverton Church together, and some other people that we knew from town come here, and so I think we just thought, well, let's try it out. I grew up in the missionary church at Walmart Center, so I've always kind of, you know, it's always been in my heart for the missionary church. I've never really been, I don't know if this is a good thing to say in a church, but I've never really been a denomination-focused person. I always felt that everybody should just go to church for God and love God and love Christ, not go because it's a missionary church, it's a Presbyterian. Like, I'm not big on the denomination, but I know the missionary church does really good things. And so we thought, let's check it out. My wife grew up in the Mennonite church, and so she was, you know, likes those customs. And so, but no, we love it. It's great. So
now, you were obviously raised in the church, but there was a time that your parents' faith and your church, that faith became your faith. And do you remember, was there, like, when you heard the gospel message and the light kind of went on and you said, you know, there's something more to this Jesus and I want to follow him?
Yeah, I did grow up in a Christian family. My father's a pastor, and my mom is more or less too. Like, they both had a ministry growing up. They started in the 70s, and so yeah, it was a very, very big part of my life. I guess the time when I accepted Christ, it was during the, I don't know if anybody's ever seen the Heaven's Gates and Hell's Flames play. So that's when I, you know, did the altar call. But I never really, I don't think I truly gave my heart to God. And I know somebody said to me years later, they said that you can come to Christ through love, or you can come to him through fear. And I think that's why I did it. And nothing against that play, but it scares you. And I mean, it really puts the fear of hell in your heart. And so,
yeah, that play scared the hell out of me too.
Yeah, it does. It does.
I got saved at that play.
So you're like, I guess I'm going up because I don't want to go there. So I never really felt that I did it for the right reasons. And, So I think So I always kind of lived, you know, I lived the Christian life, but I didn't. I had two lives, and my other life wasn't great. I did a lot of bad things, like a lot. And I think the turning point for me was I was in a gospel singing group. I know everybody laughs, but and so I was with them for I don't know how many years. I'd like to say 8 years, but I'm not even exactly sure. And so we did a lot of concerts and stuff, and we were up in at Carrick Camp up by Newstad. And during the concert, I kind of shared a little bit about my life and what God means to me. And then I was driving home by myself, and I got halfway home, and I heard God speak to me. He just said, "What are you doing? Like, you say you're living for me, but you're not. You're going to go home, and you're going to go back to work this week, and you're going to be your same old Tim." He goes, "What are you doing? Like, I want to say, you know, that one, or get off the pot." I don't think he said that, but but so right there, I pulled over and I started to cry and weep, and I thought, yeah, like what am I doing? I can't. Why am I living this double life? And so I think from that point forward, I just thought, you know what, it's all or nothing. And then I got married, or I was married, but then we, you know, through Irene and. We just started to grow, and then we got the girls came, and I thought, I got to stop living like that if I want, you know, because sins are passed down to generations, and I didn't want them to have that, so, yeah.
Well, that's exciting. Now, recently, you guys have had some really, like, a big change in your life, and I'm sure that didn't come easy, and there must have been some times of, oh, God, what are you doing? So can you share a little bit about that?
Sure. We did have an opportunity to buy the hardware store that I was working at for 4 years. The owners approached us, and they really felt that we were the ones that they wanted to take over the store, which surprised us. I mean, we were in absolutely no position to do that, so we kind of laughed a bit, you know, and yeah, okay, you know, shoved it off, and they kind of kept on us, and they said, you know what, we really feel that you guys are the ones to do it. And so we prayed about it, probably not as much as we should have. I really wanted it because I've been there, you know, I've been working there, and both Irene and I, we've both been with the Home Hardware for a lot of years, like a lot of our lives, and so we were familiar with it, but I really wanted it. Irene wasn't so sure because she wasn't, you know, involved like I was as much. And it's a big, that's a pretty big commitment. And so we just really had to lean on God. And yeah, there was one time, and it didn't come easy. I mean, it was a lot. But there was one point where it didn't look possible. And I know Irene was, she's like, yeah, that's it. We can't do it. And I was pretty upset. And I remember coming to church, and I didn't say a word. I didn't sing. I just stood there. And I don't know if I was angry at God, because I thought, you brought us this far. And I remember the sermon wasn't about faith, but you did touch on it. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to have faith, and I'm just going to put it out there, and I'm going to put it to God and say, if this is what you want, it's going to happen. And so we went home that night, and we got a phone call from somebody, and they said, it's been placed on my heart that I want to help you guys. And we're like, ha. Oh. So, yeah, that was... That was it. So we're like, okay, from now on, I'm not even going to make any decisions. We're going to pray about it and let God do it. And yeah, just kind of everything just fell into place. And so, yeah, it's been amazing. Like, we've had, it's been in that family for 65 years. And I don't know, I mean, you guys are all from the small town. When there's change in a small town, it's not easy for a lot of people. And So we weren't real sure. We've been there for 20 years in Overton, but you're never real sure. But I have people coming up to me that I thought would be like never coming in the store ever again or mad, and they're coming and they're just so happy. And I think tell me if I'm going too long here. I think the hardest thing for me was I thought, is it selfish for us to be doing this because I've always felt like I felt God calling me out to the mission field, and my brothers are in the mission field, and I thought, that's what God wants me to do. He's given me gifts to do that. And that's my phone going off. And so I thought, is this selfish of me to, like, it's not, maybe God doesn't want this for me. I'm sitting on my, maybe God doesn't want this. Maybe I want this. And, I'm just thinking that he's blessing and blah, blah, blah. So anyway, I think what changed my mind about that, I was talking to a couple, we're in there in the store, and we were talking about something that was like the total opposite of witnessing. We were talking about washers and dryers. And I was explaining the washers and the dryer, and the guy looked at me and he said, "I really feel the Holy Spirit in you." I thought, well, all right. He goes, "Yeah, I just feel a real good peace and a real sense about you." And I was like, "Oh, wow, thanks." And so anyway, we got talking, and where we go to church and where they go to church. And so I thought, yeah, this can be what a huge mission field. Like, people are coming into us, and we just got to tell them. So.
And I think that's so important, because we've talked about that before, how God places you in places, and we got students, we got people in all different lines of work, and they could be just going, "Ugh, what is my life?" But this is your mission field, wherever you're planted, wherever you're placed. And so I think that's really encouraging. And so, just in closing, how would you encourage someone this morning that's kind of in the same place where you were? They were either trying to decide, should we do this? This is a big change. Our life is going to be totally turned upside down. Or, God, where are you? You led us this far. And what's happening now? How would you encourage somebody this morning?
Just to put 100% of your faith in God. I think Carter nailed it the one Sunday morning when he had the stool. And he's leaning on it. And I thought, just like put it all on God. And I mean, you have to be, some of it has to be with you too. Like, you have to, you have to trust, and you have to have faith, and you have to listen. Like, you can't just, pray and not listen for what he's telling you. You have to listen.
And it may take some legwork.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you have to be, if he wants you to change, you have to change. But yeah, no, for sure. Like, it's, we put a lot of faith in God and just said, if this is what you want, then this is what we'll do. So, and it's good. So,
okay. Well, let's pray for you. Father God, we want to thank you so much for Tim and his life and his family, for Irene and the girls. And we just pray you'll continue to bless them. Thank you for his story. And Lord, I pray that this has been an encouragement to people and a challenge for people. And I pray your blessing upon their business. And God, just let the floodgates open for them and use this as a ministry for those coming in, Lord God, who may be having a difficult time and they're coming in to buy screwdrivers or a washer and dryer or whatever, Lord. I pray that, Jesus, you will use Tim and all of those there to just shine your light. So we thank you, Father. Thank you that you use all things and everything. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, thanks so much for sharing. It was great. Thanks. We're going to invite Kimberly to come on up. Kimberly White. And so many times the wife of a pastor is known as just that. Oh, she's the pastor's wife. They do have names, first names. And Kimberly is here, and she's going to share a little bit about who she is, how she came here, and just whatever God has put in your heart. So welcome, Kimberly.
Thank you.
So you ended up in Lista. Well, we know you know, you came with your husband, but what is your side of the story a little bit?
My side of the story. Yeah, our move to Listowel was a crazy, like, experience because, gosh, it was crazy. We got married in July, and then we thought, and we got this apartment that was just like a summer sublet. Because we thought, okay, well, Carter's contract at the church we're working at ends in August. And so we're probably going to have to move somewhere. So let's not settle in this place for a long time. We'll take a sublet till August 31st. And then we'll pursue God and see what he has for us. And so we did that. And it was great until August, like, 1st or 2nd. And I thought, well, where are we going to live at the end of the month? And then the job, there was a potential that it was going to be extended. And so they were like, just give it a few days and we'll let you know. And so I'm like, okay. And then August 10th rolls around. And I thought, well, gosh, where are we going to live at the end of the month? And so August 15th, and I'm still thinking. And so there was one day, it was a Monday morning or something, and Carter, we were going somewhere, and I just snapped. I don't know. I said, Carter, we haven't even looked at apartments yet. We have nowhere to live in August 31st. You have no job. What are we going to do? And he was like, oh, did you want me to start looking at apartments? And I said, yes. I mean, I don't know. I don't understand this marriage thing yet. We've only been married for a little over a month. What are we going to do? Where are we going to live? And so, you know, and Carter's mom, bless her heart, kept sending text messages. You can always live in our basement. We'd love to have you guys closer to home. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh. And so finally it was like a Tuesday or something, or like a Wednesday. And I was like, that's it. We're going to email all of these apartment places in Waterloo, and we're going to just find a place to live in Waterloo. And so we started emailing them all, and we were like, can we set up a time to meet? Can we set up? And we're setting up all these times. And then a little thing pops up on Carter's computer screen that says Jeff Wood. And I said, oh, not with the Listowel again. I said, what's this? And Carter said, well, let's see. And he opens it and it says, Carter, are you still interested? We would love to interview you. And I said, close everything. We're going to Listowel. And he said, Wait. I said, Carter, it can't be a coincidence that here we are looking for apartments. I had told him by Friday we were, like, committing to an apartment. And all of a sudden, here comes Listowel again. So Carter said, well, let's go and see. And so we went and we saw and we had the first interview and we got in the car and we were like, wow, this is actually, like, a really great place, you know? Like, people always talked about Listowel and we thought it, you know, like, all I knew about Listowel was people brought their horse and buggies to the grocery store. And I'm from outside of New York City, and so I thought, I don't know if I can adjust. So we ended up coming, and then Carter came back, and so, you know, we're still packing up all of our stuff, and we were going to the States for a week or something like that to visit family. And so we ended up having a place to kind of stay. My sister had moved, and we put down a cot mattress in the middle of her old apartment or old house she still had while she moved into her new one, and we just kind of squatted for a week or two. And then and then we moved here to Listowel, and so it was definitely a journey. I'm a big journaler. I write in my journal almost every day, and so I was looking at it just this week, and I was looking at August, like, 10th or something, and I was like, God, where are we going to live? Where are we going to work? Like, what are you doing? And so, so it really was last minute. Like, I was stacking up cardboard boxes for moving and to set up house outside in the streets. I was like, Carter, we're going to be in cardboard boxes or in your parents' basement. Yeah, but it worked out great.
So about your faith journey then, in all of that, because obviously you knew God was present. You knew he had some kind of plan on, but what was going on in there? Because sometimes people, you know, they just have this preconceived idea that as those in ministry, we got it all together. We don't worry. We just trust and we just float along. But share a little bit of the reality.
Yeah. So anxiety and I are no strangers, which it's funny because you would think that not only am I a pastor's wife, I'm also a therapist. And so I should know how to deal with anxiety. No. And so throughout it, like I was so anxious and I would wake up in the middle of the night, you know, and I was like, we're going to be living in on the streets and this is God's testing us. And Carter probably thinks it's so great. We'll get to go hang out at Ray of Hope. We actually went to Bailey and Mike Stag and Doan. He was like, oh, get used to Ray of Hope. Look around. This is where we're going to be for the, and I was like, Carter, don't joke about this. Not that I was like, this is really a reality. And so I was like, God, what are you
doing? Ray of Hope, for those of you who don't know,
a homeless shelter and a food bank and
where so people come in to get free meals and
yeah. So Carter was like, "This is where we're going to be coming for our meals for the next few weeks." And I was like, "Carter, stop it! Like, look for an apartment instead of saying these things." And so you know, I would look for apartments all the time because I was like, where are we going to live? Where are we going to live? And then even when Listowel came up, I was like, okay, looking for apartments in Listowel. And I couldn't really find any. And I was like, okay, well, what are we going to do? Where are we going to go? And so I like to plan everything. Like I'm like, you need to have every detail laid out or I can't sleep. And it wasn't that kind of situation. It was like, okay, God, I know nothing of what's going to happen. I have no idea where we're going to work, where we're going to live. Like, I have a job, but if we move far away, then I lose my job. And that throws a whole bunch of things into it because that's where my health care comes from as an American citizen and not a Canadian. So then I'll lose all of that as well. And I was like, I have nothing. And so there was a lot of tears and there was a lot of frustration, but it came to the point where I was like, well, God, I have nothing, but I have you. So I have everything and I can't do anything. I can't create an apartment for us to live in out of nothing. I can't get a job for us. Like that's the only things that you can do. It was kind of like a God, you're all I got. So that's what I'll have to trust in.
So now how do you feel like this has increased your faith or strengthened your faith?
Yeah. There are those moments where you sit down and you think, gosh, look what God's done. I journal, and sometimes this is bizarre. I journal ahead, like I'll flip 20 pages ahead and I'll write a letter to myself. Dear Kimberly, these are all the things you're going through. How has God worked? And then as I continue journaling 20 days later, a month and a half later, however far I flip ahead, I get to that page and I think, oh my goodness. Like 3 months ago, we thought we would have nowhere to live. We would have no job. You know, what would we be doing? And yet God provided an incredible congregation. I can still work at my job. I was petrified about learning how to drive standard, and I have not gotten in an accident yet, which is incredible. And so all of these things, we like to say they fell into place, but they were preordained. Like God had gone before us, had prepared the way, had taken care of every step. And here I was like freaking out about the little things. And so it gets me to this place where when I start to feel that anxiety, I think God has been so faithful in the past and he will continue to be faithful. It's just me that needs to be faithful in trusting and believing and leaning upon him. It definitely has strengthened I know that God will prepare, you know, he's prepared and he's continuing to go before us. And so, there's been times that I'm like, oh, I should probably do things because I'm so trusting God to do things. And then I realize, oh wait, I have a part to play too. Like I should fill out paperwork or do things like that. But yeah, so it's been incredible .
Yeah, so, and again, it is, we put our trust in God, but he does also ask us to go that little extra mile, because sometimes things don't just fall into our laps without us doing some, again, legwork.
Yeah, no, I would love if permanent residency fell into my lap, but I'm pretty sure I have to do a ton of paperwork.
That's great. Now, I want to encourage, like, all people, but particularly those young marrieds who don't have children, because you guys are passionate about connecting with people. So if you are a young married and you haven't, we wanted to encourage you before Carter and Kimberly came, because I knew by faith that they were coming. I just knew it. They didn't know it yet, but I knew God had said. So I want to encourage you to reach out to them and just contact them, Facebook or email or whatever, and just let them know who you are, and we're just young and married too, and let's just get together, hang out, and do some cool stuff together. There's actually an open house at your apartment today.
Yeah, from 2 to 7, open house. I was like a few minutes late to church today. It's the first time in a long time. But it's because Zara's didn't know how to ring up cinnamon sticks. I had them, but they said they didn't sell them, and I was very confused. So it confused the whole store. But from 2 to 7 today, there will be cinnamon sticks in the hot apple cider that's currently in my crock pot. And we made about 40 dozen cookies, and so feel free. And if you're not married and you're young and you still think, oh, well, they seem pretty cool, we are. So feel free to stop in as well. Carter's probably way cooler than I am, but he forgives me on that part. And, yeah, so feel free to get to know us.
Yeah, so everybody's invited. Well, I, for one, am so thankful that you and Carter said yes and you came to Listowel, and we are... As a congregation, we're just so blessed, and we love you guys so much. So let's pray for them. Father, I want to thank you again for showing your faithfulness and your goodness and how you just have things all planned out. And Jesus, we just have to trust. And sometimes trusting means just biting our tongues and just saying, Lord, I don't know what to say, I don't know what to do, but I'm going to trust you. And so I want to thank you for Carter and for Kimberly. And I thank you for Kimberly and her heart. I thank you for her ministry, the way she just loves people, the way she loves our young people, and the way that you use her. And I pray for her in her job setting and this commute back and forth. Lord, you know her heart and the desire of her heart. And I just pray that you will just continue to pour your blessing upon their home, on their marriage, that you will use them powerfully in this church as they are just released to do what it is that you have called them to do here in Listowel. Again, Father, I thank you so much for bringing them here. We are incredibly blessed as a church family, and we just pray you will continue to use them and just use them for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks so much.
Good stuff. Well, just wrapping up, this is our third Sunday in Lent, or Lent, sheesh, in Advent. Yeah, Lent's coming. I'm already planning ahead. And then next week during Sunday morning, we are having our Christmas play. So plan to be here for that, or we're doing it in the evening as well, Sunday evening. And if you can't make it in the morning, then come in the evening, or come to both and bring family and friends and spread the word. But just wrapping up our theme, Romans 12:12, it says, be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. Now, this is a powerful verse. Amen. Like that says so much. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. And we've seen that this morning in these testimonies. In the Christian life, it ought to be joyful because it is hopeful. Amen? And we talked about why it is hopeful, and that is because it is good news. Last week we talked about the good news. It's good news for all people, and that good news is the salvation through Jesus Christ. And so in that life, if it is full of joyful hope, it will be patient. If there is that joyful hope, then there is a patience that kind of comes to that. Lord, I trust you. I know that you've got things in control, and I can be patient that. My heart will be filled with a calm gladness because my eyes are fixed on the heavenly, on the celestial, that hope that will bring patience. And you may be familiar with John Newton. John Newton, he's the one who wrote Amazing Grace. In this hymn, he says this, though painful at the present, 'twill cease before long, and then, oh, how pleasant, the conqueror's song. And so what he's basically telling us is that we are supposed to be living in the light of eternity. What you're going through now will not last forever. And a couple of weeks ago, I said, in 100 years from now, what you're going through won't matter. It really won't make any difference at all. And what is happening right now will not last forever. And so I want to encourage you with that. It's like a man who is sailing to America from London. He knows that he'll be in New York in a week. But he doesn't mind, even though his cabin is cramped, even though he's got many discomforts, even though he is struggling with seasickness. And I don't know if anybody's ever experienced seasickness. Ooh, that is the worst. These disagreeables, you realize, they're only going to last a short while. So this hope, this understanding helps us to bear the trouble and not make much of it, because we know one day this is going to come to an end. Our lives will be joyful and hopeful and patient in proportion as they are prayerful. We want to pray through all of these things. And I like 1 Thessalonians 5:16 to 18. It says, "Rejoice always. Pray continually. Give thanks in most circumstances." Is that what it says? No, all circumstances. "For this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus." Now, he's not saying that all circumstances are good. All circumstances are easing. All circumstances are wonderful. But he's saying, give thanks for them anyway. Trust God in those anyway. Because our relationship with Jesus, it makes things different. Recently, my wife likes to listen to a radio station in the States. It's called KSBJ. And they have this thing all through the month of December. It's called the Joy Pledge. And they say this. They say, "Because of our relationship with Jesus, we can learn to be joyful in any circumstance. Joy is a decision deeply rooted in faith, hope, and trust in God. Joy is deeper than happiness and lasts longer than excitement, and joy is easy to achieve." Now, the Joy Pledge is this. It's choosing Jesus, and it's because we know that Jesus is the reason for the season, and all season long, this radio station just keeps pumping out and challenging you to take the Joy Pledge, and this is what the Joy Pledge is. It says, "I need joy, and when I keep my eyes on Jesus, I have joy, and when I lose it, I will choose it. I choose joy." Now, we were listening to this radio station the other night when my wife and I, we were downstairs and we were working on some Christmas projects. And you know what it's like, the time pressure's on, tons of things going on. This is probably the busiest December we've ever had in years. And so we got this, the time pressure's on, we're working on this thing. It wasn't coming together very well. It was late, we were hungry. We were kind of, well, I was going to say we were kind of miserable. She was miserable. I was... Actually, I was the one that was miserable. She was good. But I was just, and then we get this text that was good, you know, about some family drama that's going on, just so that you know, pastors are not, you know, we have family drama too that goes on. And it's just like, seriously? And this is not working, and it's not coming together. And it's just, oh, this is a lot of work, all of these things. And then this radio station is going, "Choose joy, choose joy. It's up to you to choose joy. Be joyful." And I'm just thinking, do we have to listen to this nonsense right now? Like, is there not some other radio station we could be listening to? Because I was not feeling, it was just pushing my buttons. And it was, but I knew that it's like, Lord, this is not an accident. And so I said, I have to choose joy. I have to choose joy. I have to choose joy. Doesn't mean I'm going to feel all wonderful, but I just have to choose joy. And I really like the definition that I read last week from Rick Warren, that it says, "Joy is the settled assurance that God is in control of all of the details in my life, the quiet confidence that ultimately everything is going to be all right, and the determined choice to praise God in every situation." Now, in light of that, I want to read some scripture. And so just listen to this scripture, listen to this story, starting in verse 1 in the book of Luke. It says, "In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, who was a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And the angel went to her and he said, 'Greetings, you are highly favored. The Lord is with you.' Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of a greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid. Mary, you have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And so the Holy One has to be born, and he will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she who is said to be barren and is in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said." And the angel left her. Now, a little later on, this is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and didn't want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, "The virgin will be with child and would give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and he took Mary home as his wife. But he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. Do you notice that life is full of interruptions? At this time of year, as I said already, my wife, she spends most of this season sitting behind her sewing machine. And she absolutely loves it. And we have some really cool projects and we're really excited about for the children this year and our older kids. But when I come home this week, I eagerly ask her, "So, how is it going? How is the sewing going?" And her reply is, "I would be nearly done some of these things if I even had 1 hour of uninterrupted time." And anyone with children is going, mm-hmm. I know, because these kids, for whatever reason, have to eat. And they have to eat regularly. And they can't make themselves their own meals. And so somebody has to feed them. And there's one thing, and then there's another thing. And it's all good. And you know, we love all being parents and everything. But sometimes you just think, oh, if only you could just... And life is full of that. Interruptions really throw us off our game, right? They do. Especially if you're the type of person who, one, is either really scheduled and has to have each moment planned, or two, you leave things to the last minute and you have only this set amount of time to get things done, or three, if you're constantly running late. Now, in the moment when you're interrupted and you're in a rush, your car won't start or your computer freezes up and you're just like, "I just need to print this off," and your computer, it's frozen up, or for whatever reason you forgot and you drove down the main street of Listowel instead of taking the back street where there's less traffic. Or that is the time when you go into the grocery store and you meet one of the dear saints who decides to tell you all about everything that is happening on their Christmas holidays. They tell you the names, the dates, and then they go into telling you what they're going to eat and all of the ingredients to make these wonderful meals. And you're just going, "Come on." And you're freaking out inside, just going, "I don't have time for this." I think about Mary and Joseph. Mary and Joseph, here they were planning a wedding. And I don't know if it's the way we plan weddings today, but all this was going on according to schedule. Everything was good. Well, then all of a sudden, whoa, there before Mary is an angel and appears and totally throwing a wrench into their plans. Everything. Everything that they had planned, and they take this interruption with great stride, I have to admit. Like, you read the story. We just read the story. And there it is. And, of course, Joseph, it took him a little bit longer, but he eventually comes alongside. And so I want to encourage you, the next time you are faced with those interruptions in your busy day, smile, sigh, and say, thank you, Lord. When you are sitting at that incredibly long light at the listable intersection that just seems to last forever. Now, every time if I'm going which direction anyway, I will stop in front of the hardware store and I'll leave myself so I can sit and look in the window, because I can probably do all my shopping right there in that 27 minutes it takes for that light to change. So the next time you're at that intersection, just thank God and say, Lord, thank you. And I love what Joseph and Eva's father-in-law said, just how when the cock crows, thank God that you're alive and you're awake and you're able to hear it. Another thing, control. So interruptions come, but control. Control is a funny thing, and I want to take a second to show this. Okay, just look at this. You've probably seen this already online, but this was from the CBC News. You'll notice that the brakes are on. Oh. There's a salt truck. He's going to make it all better. And we all feel that same sick feeling, right? We actually had that very thing happen to us. Coming to an intersection, my family's in the car, and we just slid right out into the street, and I was just praying the whole time, oh God, please, let us not get killed. But being out of control, there's just something about that, isn't there? Because we all want to be in control. It can be scary, it can be upsetting, or it can be shameful. Try and control that sneeze, and you don't have a Kleenex, and you're in a meeting. Right, and it's just like, what do I do with this now? Or you've ever had an upset stomach or a child with an upset stomach. And what went down is coming up and there is no controlling it. And it's even worse if it's the other end. And you're just running and you're just going, oh, this can't be happening. There's no controlling it. And we some of us go, oh, that's kind of crude. We can all relate. We all know that awful feeling. There's something about losing control and not being in control of yourself. And I'm not a super control freak, but I do like to plan. And I like to organize. And I like to know what's going on. And I like things to go according to my plan. But in my job, I work primarily and I depend on other people. And if you've noticed anything, is that you cannot afford to be a control freak when you are working with all kinds of other people, or you are having an African wedding and you're waiting for all the people to show up. According to my schedule. And so you just have to sit back and relax and go with it. Now, again, if you look at the story of Mary and Joseph, first they were interrupted, but they had no control over their lives. Nothing. They had no control. God didn't say, Mary, if it's okay, I'd like to choose you. He just sent the angel and he said, you are the one. Mary, you have been chosen. And he just drops it on them. He doesn't give them a choice. And so often that happens in our lives. Things just happen out of our control. We don't have a choice. And we would love to kind of have some control of the things that happen in our lives, but it just doesn't happen. And I love what Mary said. And I try and pray that this would be the heart's response of mine when God would say, here, this is what's happening. Mary says, I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said. Now imagine that. Here, he has dropped this thing on her, and may it be to me as you have said. And then Joseph, when he wakes up, Scripture says, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and he took Mary home as his wife. Now, joy in the midst of not being in control. That is a challenge. Now, what are you trying to control in your life right now? Who are you trying to control in your life right now? Because it doesn't work. And so just releasing those things, what we simply need to say and pray, God help me to be like Mary. I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said. And then we need to trust him. And then one of the last things, expectations. So we have interruptions, control, and expectations. Expectations are a really funny thing. It's really hard to balance between having too many expectations, to having no expectations, to having realistic expectations. My daughter, she just loves this one TV show. She loves it, loves it, loves it. And she was all in it, and the season ended several years ago. And so they were making this big remake, and everybody was all, you know, excited about it. And she was all excited about it. And we planned this big family time. We were going to all watch it together, but it just didn't work out. And so she had to watch it on her own. And I just kept getting these texts. What have they done? They've destroyed my show. The characters are foolish, and the story, the plot is ridiculous, and it's not the way that it was, and it's awful. And she says, I don't even think I can watch it. And she was so discouraged and disappointed after months and months of waiting and all this hype and pumped up, and she just said, I'm so disappointed. My expectations have been shattered. Now that is like the most ridiculous thing ever. But she's a young girl, and so you let her away with that. But we have expectations in our lives. We have expectations that things are supposed to go a certain. You plan a nice meal. We got the families coming together, and you want everything to be great, and then people cancel at the last minute. Or the one who was bringing a vital part of the meal, they say, oh, is that what you wanted? I forgot. And it's just like, what? The one who's supposed to be bringing decoration is like, oh, yeah, well, they didn't have that, but I brought this. And it's like, oh, well, that's not what I wanted. That's not the same color as my theme. And all of these things. And so our expectations, they just kind of go downhill. And I think of Mary and Joseph. And you think about the whole story. They're told by the parents. So first off, they're interrupted. And it's like, okay, we'll do what you want us to do because we really have no choice because they are out of control. Their control is taken away. And so here they are, and they are thinking they are going to be the parents of the Messiah, the Son of God, the Savior of the world. And I don't know, but I tend to think they might have had some expectations about how things would be a little bit differently than they turned out. Here they end up with a scandal because she's pregnant out of wedlock. Everybody would have known. So it's like, then they end up with a quick wedding, a travel to Bethlehem, a walk that is like from Nazareth to Bethlehem. It's approximately a 90-mile trip, and scholars suggest it would have taken about 4 to 7 days of walking to get there. And the whole donkey that we see Mary on, that's not even, we don't even know if that's actual. She probably walked. We just like to think the donkey was a nice little addition to the story, so somehow historically it got in there, but it's not biblical. So she probably walked 8 or 9 months pregnant. So just picture that. And then she goes and thinking, okay, the Messiah, God, you got this all under control. There's got to be a nice bed somewhere. She ends up with no room at the inn, rejected by all of the innkeepers, and ends up having her baby in a stable, in a manger, placing him in a manger. And then the ones who come to see him are shepherds and the local rabble. And so I don't know about you, but I would tend to think if God has called me to do something so wonderful, so incredible, I would have expectations that, wow, this is going to be great. I'm probably going to give birth in a hospital somewhere that is like the, you know, the for the elites, or, you know, he's going to have silk sheets and wrapped up and but here's what happens. So I think their expectations were probably, wow, okay, I kind of thought things were going to go a little differently. And many Christians, we expect the same thing. We expect that once we come to Christ, our big sugar daddy in the sky is going to make our lives sweet. This is the expectation that so many have. And God says, but that's, I never promised that. I never said that at all. And so we need to yield. Or we need to surrender our expectations to God. And like Jesus, remember when Jesus, he came to the cross and in the garden, he said, not my will, but yours be done. And he just gave it all to the Lord. And so I want to encourage you and challenge you. What are your expectations? It's okay to have some expectations. It's if we have no expectations, then we're kind of cynical and miserable. But we want to make them kind of realistic. Let's have some realistic expectations. And then if they don't turn out, just say, whatever. You just have to run with it. You just have to smile and go with it. So finding joy in the midst of interruptions, when you're out of control, and when your expectations are not met the way that you would like. I love that verse in closing, Romans chapter 12, verse 12. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. And remember, as we said last year, we have that hope in Jesus, in the good news, because it's good news that will bring us great joy. Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you for our time together. And Lord, what wonderful testimonies, what a wonderful music and time to share, and what a wonderful story to be reminded of. Lord, and I'm not making trite or belittling people's situations, because we've all got them. We've all got them, Jesus. But I pray, God, that even from now on out, we will try hard not to let these interruptions that come to steal our joy, not allow them to make us miserable or to make us grumpy or short. God, I pray that when we are out of control, when our lives are feel like they're out of control, that, Lord, we will be able to have the trust in you. And as Mary said, Lord, I am your servant. Let it be to me as you have said. And then, God, I pray that you will help us to yield our expectations. And sometimes, God, we have high expectations and we don't even know it until they kind of get shattered. And so, God, I pray you'll help us there to be realistic in those. I thank you, Jesus, for the hope that we have, the joy that we have, for the good news that brings us great joy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you as you are challenged this week to choose joy. And don't forget to join us for lunch if you can in the gym. We've got lots of food, everybody.